Number 13, as we stand, please. Because you're worthy to be worshipped. Lord, let everyone here bring their worship with them. And Father, in every mouth, we thank you for your forgiveness. We thank you for Jesus and the debt he paid for us. Lord, today we pray the presence of the Holy Spirit would fill every heart. And Lord, you'd empty me of me and fill me with the Spirit of God to preach the truth, your word, in every manner and in every way. Thank you, Lord. Be with those today that we know are traveling and not here today. We pray, Lord, that you'll just watch over them. Let them understand that we've missed them. And again, Lord, that you'll return them home safely. And Lord, we have some that are sick. We have some that are recovering. We ask you, Lord, if you would just have your healing hand upon them. Now, Father, we bow humbly before you this day and say thank you. And to be merciful unto us, the sinner, that we ask it all through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, it's good to be back in the house of the Lord. Just a couple of announcements we're going to go on with our service. April the 19th, again on Wednesday, we're continuing our Bible study. We're still probably just a little over halfway through. And I pray that if you haven't been a part of that Bible study, you'd consider it, because I think without a doubt, 1 Corinthians is going to be a book that lets you know the corruptness of the church at Corinth. And sometimes we ask a lot of questions that 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians can answer. How did I get in this shape? What's happened to the church? Why is it like it is? A lot of questions are answered because the most corrupt church was Corinth. And it had a lot of idols, just like a lot of the churches do today. So I hope and pray that you'll take time for that Bible study. April 20th, Ladies Prayer Group. And that's going to be at 6:30. And Men's Fellowship will be at Catfish Cove at 6 o'clock. So April the 23rd is going to be Baptist Women's Day. Now, they'll do the morning service, and then, of course, we'll have the evening service. And I hope and pray that you'll be supportive and be praying for them, because I know it's good. Yes, ma'am?
I believe
it's 6.
I was going to, yes,
what is
I
it?
Forgot to change it.
It's 6 o'clock.
Our practice on Thursday night, ladies' prayer group, is 6 o'clock.
Okay. All right, so it's not 6:30, 6 o'clock. Okay, any other announcements I may have missed? Okay, thank you.
I've got one more. I'm just real pleased to say that so far we have $833 for the Any strong offering, we're just $67 short of our goal. So we still have time to the end of the month.
But we have some that's going in today also.
Awesome.
Okay.
I want to thank everyone.
So that's wonderful. I think that's wonderful that we're meeting our goal for the Annie Armstrong. Now, for you that don't understand Lottie Moon and Annie Armstrong, Lottie Moon Christmas offering is for international. But the Annie Armstrong is here in the United States. And we need to realize how important that is. If we ever needed people and missionaries to come and speak, it's to our nation. I mentioned this before, I'll mention it again. We used to have more missionaries leaving this country to go somewhere else. And now our morals have dropped so bad in this country. Church attendance and COVID and all the things that's come. And the church has been battered. And a lot of Christians have been battered. And they've changed their way of thinking. The Lord says, renew your mind. Remove the things that you know in your imagination that's going to keep you from coming to worship Him. So I hope and pray today that you realize above all things that we need the missions. So everything you're giving is for somebody in this country to witness to somebody in this country that may bring them to know Jesus Christ for the first time. Or reminding them that they need to be back in church. So I hope and pray you'll support the Annie Armstrong missions. All right. Any other announcements I may have missed?
Take your hymn books again and turn to number 159.
Thank you. Sorry. Walking on the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that we came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. And when we reached that city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers and no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. And then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify him! We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy. The people gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. And I still hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus, and I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled, and I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, and the crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, you carry his cross. first I tried to resist him. Then his hand reached for his sword. And so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder, started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha, where they drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet on the cross I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. To thy hands I commend my spirit. He prayed, then he died. I stood for what seemed like years, and I lost all sense of time, until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping as I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us, the lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
Thank you, Scott. You know, if you have your Bibles, find Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. And in a moment we'll begin reading. But on that day when Christ was crucified, there was a lot of fear. There was a lot of confusion. As I'm going to speak about two that were confused and arguing about what they had saw. We sing a song, We're Walking on the Jericho Road. And we sing it time and time again. But we sing that song, but did you know that Jericho represents the world? We're walking on the Jericho Road. We're walking on the worldly road. That's what's happening in America today. We're not walking on the Emmaus Road, which is the narrow road. It's the Jericho Road, which is the broad road, which leads to death. We've failed in every manner. When we talk about walking on the Jericho Road, we're deceived. We're deceived to think that we're on the narrow road. But we're not. And God warned us of this. The Emmaus Road and the Jericho Road look like they're the same road. You don't see the width of that. You don't see the narrowness of that. You just begin to walk and think, well, I'm right with God. I'm on the narrow road. And I know that there's probably people in the church that's not on the narrow road like me. But when you walk and you find, you're going to find out that maybe I'm on the broad road, which leads to death. How do I know which road that I'm on? Well, I think you're going to find out today, because there's many Christians that are looking for Christ, But they looked for him in a worldly way on a worldly road. They're traveling on it because the problem is they think they're traveling the narrow road which leads to life. But in reality, they're traveling the broad road which leads to death. Now, let me give you the background here. Jesus was crucified and put on that cross, and he died, and he was put in a borrowed tomb. He came out of that grave and was seen by more than 500 people at one time. And they believed because they seen the Lord. After all, does the world say seeing is believing? And how many times do we see something and we see it with each other, but yet we didn't see the same thing? That was the problem with these two that was walking on the Emmaus Road. They saw everything together, but they saw it in a different light. One of the things that I think we'll find here is when Christ approached them. But they were seeing, and their seeing was their confusion. You see, they began to discuss what they saw, and they began to be confused in their own way. Now, why in the world, if they believed that Christ was risen again, why did they leave Jerusalem? Well, in a moment I'll mention it. Why didn't they stay? Well, it's because they had heard from the women that they had seen the risen Lord. But they didn't stick around. Now they're confused. Now they're fearful. And they said, I've had enough. I'm going home. How many times have you been in a situation and you hear maybe away from home arguments and things and it seems to have got out of hand and you say, man, I just want to go home. I just want to leave. I don't want to be a part of this. It happens to every single one of us. Well, these two wanted to go home. The Lord knew they were confused, but he knew they wanted to be disciples of the Lord. So as we began to look at this, they were walking along discussing what they had believed that happened, but they were in great disagreement. Now, Luke chapter 24, beginning in verse 13. And behold, two of them went that same day, meaning Sunday, to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. That's about 7 miles. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. Now, both of them are telling the other what they had seen, but they only confused one another. You know, that's simple. You might think that the worldly thing of seeing is believing, but does everybody see the same thing? No. They see things in a different light. So, verse 15, and it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, they're still trying to figure it out, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Now, their lives were holding, that means they were restrained, that they should not know him. Now, God had a purpose for not allowing them to know who he was. He could have shown them the scars in his hand and said, this is who I am. You've seen them nail me to the cross. And they would have believed. But that's not God's purpose this morning. That's not God's purpose then. As we continue to read verse 17. And he said unto them, what manner of communication are these that ye have one to another as you walk and are sad? And one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answering unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem? Now let me ask you a question. Is God a stranger in Mount Holly, North Carolina? He's not a stranger anywhere. It's just whether or not you receive him for who he is. And a lot of times, even in your house, is he a stranger to your house? Is he a stranger to your heart? So many times we know Jesus, we know about Jesus, but we do not know his ways. Therefore, we don't have that intimate relationship that we need. And through that, we need to know his ways and know why his purpose are given. You know, I couldn't help last night as Charlie visited me and we were talking. I said, well, I'm working on a message that has really blown me away in a sense. And I said, as I continue to work on it, is about Job. Now, you've heard a lot about Job, but here was Job. God had made Job rich for a purpose. Did you know that God makes people who they are for his purpose? Job was made rich for the purpose of God. When the devil came in, what did he do? He said, I know that I can make Job curse you. You see, God had the confidence when the devil had said he had been going to and fro through the land to see who he could consume. And he said, have you considered consuming my man Job? He said, I've tried many times to consume him, but you've got a hedge around him and I can't get through. And the Lord said, I'll take the hedge down because you say that you can make Job curse me. So what does he do? He takes the hedge down, but he said, you can do anything to him and to his possessions, but you cannot take his life. If you read about Job, you'll find that Job was the richest man in the whole wide world at that time. And Job was an asset to his community and to all that knew him. You see, Job used his riches to help the poor. He used his riches to testify about God. He used his riches in every way, and God had a purpose for Job's riches, and it wasn't only for that, helping his fellow man, but it was for something else. It was to take everything that God had given Job away. Now, let me tell you something about Job. Job knew when everything was gone, all of his children, everything, all of his possessions, there was none left. None. But Job didn't turn around and say, oh God, help me, the devil's done this to me. No, no, no. Job was a man with great faith. He said, God, I know that you've taken this from me. You gave it, you took it away. He said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. He knew where it was coming from. Now, I'm going to go off of Job, and I'm going to come right back to this walk with the people of Emmaus. They were confused. They were filled with fear. They did not have an understanding like Job had about God. Do you know we have a lot of Christian people that know about God, but they do not know his purpose and they do not know his ways for you, for this church, and for your family. When we get into the Word of God, we will find that God is using us. God has given us certain things. Whether you're poor or whether you're rich, there's a purpose. Job knew his riches came from God. But we have a lot of people today that says, I earned it myself. Which is very wrong. That person, my friend, is probably tithing heavily to the church, but they're walking on the Jericho Road. Because they fulfill their own understandings. They don't understand God because they do not give God the credit for giving them for what they have. So here we have two men, and they're headed home. They're confused. They're afraid. Verse 19. And he said unto them, what thing? And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. Now they're thinking that he's not God. They're thinking he's a good prophet. They think he's a miracle worker. But they do not see him as God. and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which would have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company, in other words, they're saying, these women who believe like we do and followed him, and I love that, made us astonished, which were early at the sepulcher, that's the grave. And when they found not his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulcher and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Then said he unto them, O fools. Now, a fool in the Bible is an unbeliever. And let me tell you something before I speak another word about this scripture. The worst thing you can call somebody is a fool. You can be condemned to hell for judging that person to be an unbeliever. Be careful. That word carries a lot of clout. Oh, fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? Now, here they are. They're two disciples. And I want to talk to you about what I'm going to call in three things. The first, the discouragement of a confused heart. A confused heart. These two disciples were discouraged and they were greatly confused. That's what happens when you doubt. You see, he talks about what the women had said about him being risen from the dead, but they weren't sure, they doubted. Why? Because they did not hear what he had said previously four different times. I will be taken to the Gentiles and the religious leaders, they'll crucify me and on the third day I'll rise again. But they were listeners but not hearers of the word of God, like some men. You know, 15 minutes after you leave this church, somebody may come up to you who's lost and say, what did the preacher preach on today? You know what most Christians will say? Jesus. And which they're right. But they have already forgotten. Why? Well, if you go back to the parable of the four soils, it's simple. When it talks about some fell on hard ground, stony ground, thorny ground, and good ground. Because you have to realize that if you can't remember the words of the preaching of the Word of God, what you got to do is go back and look, what kind of heart do I have? I need to have a good heart where that word takes root in my heart. And yet we fail many, many times on doing such a thing. You see, their doubting and sadness had its source and it came from misunderstanding. And the misunderstanding led them to disappointment. And the disappointment led them to doubt. And their doubt led them to discouragement. It has a pattern. And it goes from one step to the other. You know, when an unsaved person visits this church, they already have a concept about the Word of God. They come in because some unsaved, they might be. Now listen very carefully. Here's two men discussing God. I've been in beer joints in my life, and I've watched people talk about God and their concept of what God is and who God is. Now, you have to realize the Word of God says that a man that is not saved thinks that the words of God are foolishness. So here we have people that come to church with a concept of God that they got sitting on a bar stool with another unsaved person. Now, when they come and they begin to listen, it's not unusual for the unsaved to explain to each other how they can be saved. But they believe a lie when they hear the truth. They'll say, I'm not going back to that church ever again. That's happened right here. I know on two occasions. They left this church saying, that preacher, uh-uh, I'm not going to listen to this. Well, why? Well, the thing inside of them was so disturbed. Now, what is that thing inside of them? Well, I'm saved. I got the Holy Spirit in me. If you're an unsaved person, you got an unholy spirit in you. And so you're going to do the things that what's inside of you guides you and leads you to do. So here they are. They're thinking in terms, I'm not going back to that church. That's not the way it is. You know, it's the most amazing thing. How many people come and talk to me about the Word of God and know nothing about it? Don't open their Bible. Don't read. That's not a knock. That's a fact. We're to be reading the Word of God. Now, you're going to see what God's doing here. What was their misunderstanding? Well, they were looking for a political Messiah. One that would set them free from Rome. But now, hold on before you condemn them. We have a lot of folks, a lot of Christians, that are looking for a Messiah that will bless their business. Heal my sick friend. Heal me. But they're not looking for one that would forgive them of their sins. They're looking for a different type of Messiah that you believe exists. And that's why when I speak about Jericho Road and the Worldly Road, those people are on the broad road thinking that they're doing everything good for the Lord, and yet they fail in trying to please the Lord because basically they're pleasing themselves. Did you know we still have people looking for a Messiah that will deliver them from their woes? You know, the Messiah had nails for a scepter, and he had a cross for the throne, and his kingdom, it was no bigger than the tomb they laid him in. And how many followers did he have? How many believed in the resurrection? Friend, I told you last Sunday, I say it again. If you don't believe in the virgin birth, you don't believe in the resurrection, you are not a child of God.
Amen.
The resurrection is the key to your salvation. If God had not walked out of that grave, mine and your sins are not forgiven. And we're still lost. So you have to see what we're looking at today. What had happened to the kingdom? Well, after all the prophets had prophesied about the kingdom, and the poets had pictured a kingdom, and the angels had pronounced the kingdom, and Jesus spoke about a kingdom. So they had in their mind, they're hung up on one word, kingdom. He's going to establish his kingdom. And you know what? We have to realize above all things, God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts. And my ways are not your ways. But we'll begin to think God's going to do this. These people begin to say, you know what? He's about to establish his kingdom. I want to be a part of that kingdom. I want to be there. He's going to get rid of these Romans. Not so. But it had not happened the way they imagined it would. It had not happened the way they understood it. Because they had their own misunderstanding of who Jesus was and his purpose of becoming a man. If he's God, how can he die? Well, the unsaved people, they'll make a song. God is dead. They'll proclaim it. And they begin to say, you know, he's an old man. He's too old to do anything. Let me make sure you understand something. We're living in time. Time has a way of aging us. Amen? Say it. But do you know something? Eternity has no aging. God is just as young as he was from the very beginning. Now, was there a beginning and an end? No. We can't have that finite mind to make us do anything but be deceived. The infinite mind can understand there was no beginning. In our finite mind, there has to be a beginning of everything. So we cannot understand the concept of that resurrection and why Jesus, God, would come and give His life for us. We have to realize what God is speaking to us. They didn't understand that Jesus was going to turn Calvary into Easter, the resurrection and the sin payment that He did for us. You know, Jesus actually called them fools. Then He said to them, "O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets had spoken." Now, again, I mentioned, He doesn't show them the nail-scarred hands. Nor, they just didn't understand what the prophets had spoken. But not only a confused heart, but the discovery of a challenged heart. Why do we have a confused heart? Because we believe in action. And what we have to see here, that God's saying, "I don't want you to believe in a miracle. You can believe the miracle happened." Now, did you hear? Did you hear? Did you hear what I just said? "I don't want you to believe in a miracle, but you can believe the miracle happened." There's two different things here. Why did He not show them the nail-scarred hands? What did He show them? He showed them the Scriptures, the Word of God. He wanted them to believe on Him because it was forecast and made prophet after prophet after prophet speaking of Jesus Christ. And so He wanted them to believe the same as He wants you and I to believe, by the Word of God and no other way. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. That's how you believe in this God. You believe in this God in one manner. And that one manner is made very plain. Don't believe because of the miracles. You can believe in the miracles because He is God. But He don't want you to believe in the miracles. He wants you to believe in the Word of God. Now that's faith. But then there's this challenged heart. Jesus met them and challenged them with the Word of God. And I want you to see how He did it. First, He sought them in verse 15. "And it came to pass while they communed together and reasoned." Jesus had done that so many times with you and me. You know, in my study, as I'm preparing messages, I cannot even believe. I said, "God, I just don't understand how You can reveal so much to an ignorant man." But it's one of the blessed times of my life, alone with God. Amen. Believing because of the things He reveals in His Word. You know, not only did He sought them, but He caught them. Verse 15 again, "Jesus Himself drew near." I'm going to tell you that Jesus has never lost one of His sheep. And these two were His sheep. That's right. Even though they were confused and afraid, they still belonged to the Lord.
Yes.
Well, why didn't He go and do all this with Peter and John and James and the rest of the disciples? Why didn't He go get Thomas's doubt completely out of the way? Because these two people that he drew near to were just as important as anyone else. You say, "Why don't He do that?" Well, He's a preacher. That's why. Let me get this straight. Do you believe that God has favoritism? I can tell you no. He might have a greater purpose for you or for me, but He doesn't love me any less than He loves you, nor any more. I can't increase the love of God, and I can't decrease the love of God, because His mercy endureth forever. But He not only caught them, He taught them. And so we begin to see here in verse 27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded. Now, that word expounded says he is going into every little detail to explain to them so they'll have an understanding. And he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them, and it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it, and brake and gave to them. And their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. How in the world did they know him? By the word of God. He has yet to show them the nail-scarred hand. He just totally vanished. Vanished. And they said one to another, God, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scripture? Now it wasn't enough for him to open the scriptures. Go back to verse 31. And their eyes were open and they knew him. There's two things that the Lord has to open to us when we're confused and we're discouraged. First, he has to open the scriptures. Try, even in the midst of your storm. Well, preacher, I know you're going to tell me to pick up my Bible and start reading. But I don't want to. I have to think about this storm I'm in. That's exactly what the old nature in you wants you to do. That's exactly what the devil wants you to do. They don't want you to turn to the answer of the Word of God. You see, the Word of God, listen to me, will reveal the storm for what it is and encourage you to trust God in this storm because he's in that storm with you. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So we began to see he has to open their eyes. Both are absolutely necessary. Life without sight is no good, and sight without light is no good. It takes both. And the revelation of a blind spiritual person is the word of God to open those blinded eyes. Well, now why did God engineer that they would not know who he was? Well, he was in his resurrected form. There was something about his likeness that was changed. Because they had known him. They'd seen him crucified. They had heard him teach. They had had all these things. And so they absolutely knew. But you know what? They didn't recognize him. Because they didn't understand the word of God. He was explaining to them the word of God. What God had to say about who he was. So why does the Bible tell us their eyes were holding it and that they should not know him? It doesn't necessarily mean that his form had changed, but something happened to him. God in some ways distorts their vision. Why God does that? Why didn't he just say, here I am? Well, Jesus is getting ready to go to heaven. Now I want you to listen very carefully. I've had people to say, I've talked to my ex-wife. She died and I've talked with her. She's manifested herself before me. Preacher, is that possible? I said, impossible. You're talking to a demon. A demon will manifest itself into something good, but it is not there. Second thing. Your pastor dies. And when you get to heaven, I know you're going to seek Jesus first. Say amen.
Amen.
But you might say, you come up to me and you start talking to me and you'll say, I wonder where my pastor is. I've been looking for him. Well, I'm going to have the same body as Christ. I don't think you're going to recognize who I am, but the Bible says you'll know them.
That's right.
Not by sight,
but your faith.
We have too many people saying, oh, you're going to see them, you're going to know them. Listen to me. I'm going to tell you again. Job said, I know that it was God who took my things. I know, God, that you gave them to me, and I know, God, because I know who you are, God. I know you took them. Job knew God. And he knew there was a purpose behind all of it. Why? He didn't have to understand. He didn't have to question God. He just had to believe God. Just like you and I. We don't understand. We don't understand why a person in this church that was just as good could be for the church in every manner, but they're gone. Why didn't they take that one that comes to church sparingly? We needed this person. Well, God has a purpose. Well, I want to know the purpose. You may not get that purpose meaning. The truth of that is very plain. Trust God in His purpose. And that's what we should be doing. On Wednesday night Bible study, I've had some who have gone to be with the Lord, and some are here now say, I didn't understand these things in all my life, but now I'm beginning to understand a lot of things that I didn't. Well, that's the purpose of being in God's Word. You say, well, the preacher really brings it on, and we're learning a lot from the preacher. You're learning a lot from the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. Don't take God's glory and give it to the preacher.
Yes, that's right.
Give it totally to God. Now, we're seeing his transition because he's going back to heaven, but he's leaving the Word. And the written Word of God is what we have today to bring Jesus to us. Now, make Jesus Christ real to us, we must have the Word of God, which is the truth. It's significant that it was God and the Word and not the physical sense that made him real to them and to you and me. That's the only way. You see, they knew him because he opened the Word of God to them. If you think that you're going to know God because he parted the Red Sea, because he sent the 10 plagues on Egypt, because he raised Lazarus from the dead, I'm going to tell you something. You're not going to know God until you get into God's Word. John 1:1 is absolutely the power of your belief. In the beginning was the Word. Let me ask you something. When you go to do something, isn't there a beginning of doing it? When you become a Christian, there's a beginning for you to become a Christian. In the beginning was the Word. You start in the Word of God. And God in His love will reveal what you need to know. Jesus preached a sermon to them. Verse 27, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, now he's going back to the Pentateuch, the first 5 books of the Bible, Genesis 1:1 and the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures of things concerning himself. You know, it means that Jesus is in all the scriptures. The New Testament had not been written, so he started in Genesis. They started basically with Moses. Now, if you don't think Moses was important, let's go to the Mount of Transfiguration. Who was there? Moses and Elijah. You see, Moses was a type of Christ that God had used. No, he was not a God. He was not a Christ. He was a man that was in typification to lead the children of Israel by the instructions of God step by step. And no other way. And so he gives us the understanding and how we begin in the Lord. Now he told the people in his day, search the scriptures. These are those who testify of me. Now I've been preaching long enough to know that the Bible becomes a wonderful book when you find Jesus in it. You ever read the scripture? Well, let me ask you a question. And doing it in my devotion. Boy, right in the middle, the preacher went down that way rabbit hunting. Listen to me. I'm going to ask you a question. If you could name all the names of God, would you leave one out? Well, Jehovah Jireh, El Shaddai, we just keep going, right? Well, you probably don't have time to look it up, but if you'll read Exodus chapter 34, you're going to find a name that I never hear any preacher ever tell you. But God does. You know what that name is? Jealous. He says in Exodus 34, I think it's verse 10 or 14, I'm not quite sure, but he will say, my name is Jealous. Well, wait a minute, preacher. I've been jealous. And I was full of anger and hate. I was full of all of these things. You mean to tell me that God has all that in him? No. It's a spiritual jealousy. Which means very simply, you're to have no other gods than him. It's not the jealousy that man has put a definition to. God is great. God is good. God is God. Hallelujah.
Verse 14.
Amen. You know, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but there's something wrong with your heart and mind if you don't believe this Bible. And that means all of it. You know, in closing, the third thing I want you to see is the courageous heart. And that's very simple. Verse 33. And they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them. Late as it was, they hurried back to Jerusalem. Verse 34. Saying, the Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared to Simon. And they told what things were done in the way, and how he was known of them in breaking bread. And as they thus spake, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said unto them, peace be unto you. He didn't come in and say, fear me. You see, the fear I have for God is respect. I respect that he gave me life. I respect he can take it away at any time. But Job said something else. The Lord hath numbered my steps. And when my steps are counted, and God's counting, then it's over. I have a great physician in Dr. David Ionetti. He is, along with Dr. Martini, and I don't mean to drink, but my point I'm trying to make to you is they're the two prime liver and pancreas doctors in the world. I've run into doctors that see that Dr. Ionetti is the one that cut my half my liver out, and then he went and cut another 10% out. Listen to me. And they say, that man is fantastic. But do you know what? God had a purpose for this old liver cancer. He gave me the opportunity to witness to a man who didn't believe. And then he didn't believe, even though I said, well, let me have prayer with you. If it'll make you feel okay. I said, it will. And so I prayed. But I prayed a sermon. And so, no, not one of mine I normally on Sunday, because we'll still be over. But normally what I'm trying to show you is, then all of a sudden, he said, I'll see you in 4 months. 4 months, I walk in, and he's lost 55 pounds. I said, man, Doc, I need to know how you lost that weight. He said, my wife ran off with another man. He grieved. I said, where's all the other doctors? He said, I told them not to come in because I want you to pray for me. I need peace. I can't find it.
Amen. Praise God.
So what's the purpose of something? God has His purpose.
Yes. Amen.
God sent you somewhere for a reason. You might say, well, I don't know what it is. Just wait on God. He'll reveal. That's who God is. Now, this courageous heart. You know, Jesus only fellowship with those who believe in Him. And we have too many church programs that leave Jesus out. Every single thing we do should be centered around Christ. Right in the middle. Our life, our church, our worship, our family, every single thing. I'll ask you, are you ready to start a walk with Christ today? Maybe you've been on the Jericho Road, but you got an opportunity today to be on the Emmaus Road, the narrow road, the one that Christ is on. He will never meet you on the Jericho Road. He'll only meet you on the narrow road of Emmaus. Read your scripture that says, and He drew near to them. Where were they? On the road to Emmaus. What will you do with Christ today? Is the resurrection real in your life? Is Jesus real in your life? I sure hope so. And Father, we thank You for Your Word today. We thank You for the blessings of Your precious Word. Lord, let us be sure we're on that narrow road. And one of the things we know that we're on that narrow road without even question, am I Lord? No, that is not the question. The question in the prayer would be, have I met Jesus on the road I'm walking? That tells me whether I'm on the broad road or the narrow road. For I know You'll never meet us on that broad road. So thank You, Jesus, for this word that You put in our hearts today. And we pray it through Christ Jesus our Lord. Thank You. And amen. Amen.
And number 165.
Together today, be in Your house to worship and praise You. Father, we pray that each one who's heard this word today would have an open heart, good soul in that heart, Lord, that they would receive the word that was presented today. Allow it to flourish and be fruitful for you and your kingdom. Lord, we pray that you would allow us to go out today, share your word with others. Lord, that they may not walk the Jericho road, but Lord, that they may find you on the road to Emmaus. And Lord, we ask that you would just have your will and your way in our lives and those around us today. We thank you, Lord, for all the love and mercy you show us each and every day of our life. And Lord, we pray that if it be your will, you would allow us to come back this evening to hear your word preached, strongly preached. And Lord, we ask that your will be done above all. In Christ Jesus' holy and precious name we do pray. Amen.
Amen.